No.
Not at all?
The microphone's
over. Oh, this one. Okay.
That doesn't...
That's recording.
That's just for the recording.
Okay.
So, I'm Thomas Bunfort. I work with the MapServer team, and I'm going to be presenting about MapCache, which is the tiling part, new tiling, well, more or less new now, tiling server of the MapServer team. I realized I put this as a newbie presentation. It was probably meant to be newbies for people who didn't know MapCache. I'm still going to put a slide about what's a tiling server just in case. Instead of rendering images and data on demand, tiling is pre-generating small image tiles and storing them beforehand for faster access by web clients. I'm going to use a bit of terminology here that I'll explain now. So a grid is how you've cut up the space under a given projection, what different resolutions you've chosen, what's the extent of your areas of interest. A source is what I'll call the upstream data provider. So the most well-known is WMS, so something that can produce an image for a given size and extent. Other data sources could be native of MapServer, Google, MapNIC, whatever. A cache is where you're going to be storing the tiles once they've been created. A tileset is the mixing together grid, source, and cache, and serving them under a specific name. And the service is under what protocol you're going to be serving those tiles. So there are multiple protocols. What's MapCache itself now? So it's actually a tiling library more than a server. And it has it's hooked up with multiple server front ends. So it can run natively as a module inside Apache or nginx. There are some node bindings for it to run it under Node.js. And it can also run as a standalone CGI or fastcgi. It's versatile in the sense that you have lots of choices as to what kind of cache backends you can use to store the tiles. It supports multiple protocols. You've got some tile management features which allows you to seed specific areas, reseed old tiles, interpolate between tiles to create new data. It's written in native code, C code, so it's very fast. And while I put ease of deployment, easily deploying a tiling server is probably not a very strong selling point, but at least you have a small demo interface that gives you what kind of JavaScript code you should cut and paste if you want to use the service. The history, so it's 3 years old, basically, and it's under MapServer governance since 2012. So I'll first talk about the protocols which are supported. So which are the web protocols by which you can request tiles? So there's all the XYZ classical protocols, KML and WMS. So for the standard tile addressing, you can address them in TMS, which was the original OSGO tile addressing spec. WMTS, which is OGC's response to TMS to have something under OGC. Virtualearth quad keys, which I don't think are very much used. Map guide addressing either, or just plain old X and Y and Z. It also has a WMS extension, which means that it will understand WMS requests and possibly build full getmap requests out of the cached image data. So here, typically, the example is if you have one layer, which is a base layer for the roads of an area, and a second layer, which is the tiles of a radar, you can request both layers to MapCache, and it will glue the tiles together and just send you back a single tile with both image data inside it. So in terms of bandwidth, you can always display a single layer instead of stacking up multiple layers. It can also mirror a full WMS server. So in that case, you just stick it in front of a WMS server and it will cache each individual layer, and when it receives requests, will stack the layers together. Or it can also store the layers that are already stacked together. And it also forwards get feature info request in case that's something you need. So the get feature info request will be forwarded back to the up to the upstream WMS server. So that's what I wanted. And there's a last mode, which is kind of a OGC proxy. So you can put it in front of any OGC. OGC is between parentheses because it doesn't have to be OGC, but in front of any server, it will intercept requests that can be made from tiles, and whatever else it doesn't understand can be forwarded to a number of other backend servers depending on parameters. So basically you can have it as a single entry point to cache your frequently accessed layers and then forward the WFS requests or WMS requests in grids that you haven't cached or whatever to other servers. Miscellaneous features, which are usually found in tile caches. So it adds the HTTP headers to know that your browser can cache it for a given amount of time. It can automatically expire tiles. So say that your tile set should only last 5 minutes, then a request for a tile that's older than 5 minutes will get regenerated instead of being sent stale. You can choose what kind of error reporting you send back to your client. So if you want to hide your errors, you can just return an empty image or an image with the logo saying you don't have any data or an error code or whatever. Meta tiling is, I won't go into details, you can watermark your tiles. And there's a nifty new feature also, if you have low resolution data that you want to serve up to higher resolutions, instead of having to seed and or cache tiles up to all the higher resolutions, it will upsample your lower levels to return an upsampled image for the higher levels. It's made to, so it has some image operations to optimize the image data that's stored into the caches. So the WMS server, basically, most of the time you make it return uncompressed and lossless image formats, then you'll cut it up into tiles. In that case, you avoid double JPEG recompressions or whatever. So you have a it'll come later. So you can cache, be aggressive when you're storing the tiles so they have the smallest size possible, or be lean on the compression algorithm when you're doing images on the fly to put less load on your CPU. That's not what I wanted. It will detect empty or uniform tiles. Most of the, when you're tiling down to very high resolutions, most of your tiles are actually empty. You have no data on it. We're not storing the whole data, but just storing the fact that we have an empty image in a certain color. For fully seeded caches, you can also say that if I don't have a tile at some place, there's no need to go and ask the WMS server for the data. That means I have no data at this place and return a transparent image. Grids. You can define multiple grids per tile set, so you can cache multiple resolutions. Basically, your most used one is the Google Mercator ones. You can also cache WGS84 for the Globe Google Earth ones. It also understands non-standard projection codes. You can alias them in case your favorite mapping agencies have come up with their own non-standard codes. And you can also use a generic grid, but just say, I'm only interested in a subset of it, so I'm only displaying zoom levels 0 to 8, or I'm only representing tiles that cover a given extent. Up. So now there's a meat of the presentation. So it's where you're going to be storing the tiles. So there are many backends that are possible for this. A cache is actually a very simple interface that just has four methods when you tell it to does a tile exist for this one, get me this tile, put a new one, or delete a given tile. And then there's some backend specific hacks that I'll talk about. So the first kind of cache is the disk cache, so you're basically storing tiles into a file system. It's very fast because you're very close to the file system. You can do symbolic linking of uniform tiles to save on disk space, and you can choose whatever layout you're going to be storing your tiles in, or to reuse an existing layout, so the standard tile cache disk layout, or you can read ArcGIS caches or provide your own one. The cons of this cache is very difficult to manage once you've got thousands or tens of thousands, millions of files. Just knowing how many files you have, knowing the space they're taking is very slow operations. Pushing a million files up to a remote server takes a lot of time. You also very often hit file system limits, so you don't have any inodes left to store tiles. And it's not very optimal storage-wise because the block sizes on the file system don't match the actual tile sizes, so there's a waste of space here. The other kind of cache are the storing tiles as blobs in a sqlite database. So you only have a single file to manage, which is much more tractable and more efficient storage-wise. You can extend it to actually be able to give any query you want, given an XYZ, return me a blob for this tile. So that's how you can also support the mbtiles format. And so it's efficient in space. There's also something to detect blank tiles. In that case, you'll only store the RGBA quadruplet instead of the image data, and then dynamically create a paletted PNG from this and just inject the RGB header inside the PNG header. Disadvantages, it does need some tweaking if you overshoot some default SQLite limits for caches that are more than around a terabyte. So there's some configuration options you have to pass to SQLite when you're opening databases larger than that. I don't know what the exact limit is, maybe around 1 or 2 terabytes. And concurrent insertions are also quite slow. SQLite isn't made for concurrent insertions, so if you have multiple seeding instances, then you're going to hit some locks that make the insertions slow. It can store styles in a memcache or memcache compatible instances. So that's very nice if you have data that's very short-lived, basically traffic info, forecasts or whatever. You know that it's going to be valid only for a given amount of time. You can distribute that across multiple servers. Memcache does the pruning for you, so the expiration and deletion of old tiles for you. The cons are the limited storage, basically, because you're storing everything in memory. Or, well, some of the memcache compatible have disk backends, but that's it. A very interesting cache for people with basically satellite imagery use cases. We store the tiles as large JPEG files, which tens of thousands or 20,000 pixels. And we use the internal JPEG tiled representation to store the JPEG data inside the TIFF file. So when you want to access tile data, you just have to know where to hit inside the TIFF file, and you get the JPEG data directly. So this means you have to set up a hierarchy of files to know inside which tile you must be hitting for a given XYZ, whatever. But it's very, very efficient on disk space because the TIFF format doesn't duplicate the JPEG header for every tile, which is the same because you're always doing this RGB tiles that are 256 by 256. So that's only once stored once for the whole tiles inside this TIFF file. And it becomes much more tractable because you're storing basically 10 or 100,000 tiles per file. So compared to the disk cache, you've divided your number of files to store by 100,000, whatever. The disadvantages with this format is that it's limited to JPEG. The TIFF specification only supports JPEG as an internal representation, so we can't store PNG data, so basically you can store data where there's transparency in it. Concurrent writing to a TIFF file is also problematic, so you have to lock around it. If you update or delete tiles, then the TIFF library doesn't bring back reclaim the storage space that was lost by a tile. The use cases here, so there's some very large instances of satellite imagery providers who are using this. They have caches in the order of more than 50 terabytes of data stored in this format with tens or hundreds of millions of requests per month. So it's rather robust, and it's a very, very good format if the disadvantages don't limit your use case. We also have a seeder, which has some advanced seeding functionality. So it seeds with multiple threads in case your source data, so WMS server has lots of CPUs, so you can fill up your source WMS. Drill down mode, so you take advantage of the file system caches on the WMS server. You can seed particular subsets, so for a given dimension, regenerate tiles that are older than certain dates. And you can also seed given to restricted to a geometry that you can filter with the OGR SQL syntax. So you can say seed to level 18 all the cities with more than some density, so you've preceded the areas where there are a lot of people and where you know there's going to be a lot of access. There's another feature which is dimensions. So for a given tile, you can access it on multiple dimensions. So typically, you want imagery, and the dimension is the date, and you want the imagery from 2012 or 2013, whatever. So that's used for forecasts. So the weather forecast is valid for a certain date and has been created at a certain date. So you have two dimensions playing in that case. It could be also elevation, so the temperature at a given level under the sea or whatever. I have a use case here, which is the front-facing Bureau of Meteorology site of Australia, who's using that. So they have dozens of tile sets, each accessible for different time. So you can access the forecast for 3 hours, 6 hours in at the time. And this is some data that's constantly being updated as new forecasts are coming in. We also support specifically time dimension for basically satellite imagery, where for a given time you only cover a certain extent. And then so one image is taken at a precise instant of time and only covers a small area, but then you can say to MapCache, okay, create me a mosaic of all the images that were taken in 2012. And so it will fill up look into the caches for all the images that match this interval you're giving it and create a single mosaic. There'll be much more details about this presentation and all the other stuff that's with this server at the presentation at 3 o'clock this afternoon and in the other location. So I encourage you to go there if that interests you. What's coming next? Those are all possibilities. Probably not all of them are definitive. So be able to use already existing TMS or HTTP caches as a source. Use Google natively as a source for your tile data. Native, I don't know what that is. That's probably an unfinished sentence. Some caching data directly to Amazon S3 or some React clusters. Support for UTF encoded tiles, which has come into MapServer very recently, so we definitely want to support that. And I'm over.
So, any questions from Thomas?
Should time dimension kind of works for any time division, so you could do yearly or monthly or down to hours?
So the question was, is the time dimension limited in its granularity, more or less? You just give it a start and end date, and then you extract whatever intersects that interval. So. It can be a year, and in that case, your interval is from January the 1st at midnight to the 31st at midnight, 24 hours. It's whatever you want. It supports the OGC time format, so you have the granularity of year, month, day, hour, minute, second, millisecond.
Our collections over a certain time period, so that it's for this year or this month, and it'd be really nice to separate them out as separate caches so people can access those directly. But when you call for the full year, you get all those collected together. So
that's what it does. If you have many tiles under it, it will become slow, of course. If you have 10,000 data sets in that year, you do have to create 10,000 images. So. Yeah. You'd probably be better off in that case to create a cache. You can use that, but put another cache in front of it.
It won't be quite that many, but
well, maybe Stefan knows roughly when it stops scaling. But 10,000 is probably you've stopped already.
Anybody else?
Yes. Is there a utility? Maybe with the seed utility or another one that one could use to extract a portion of the cache and copy it to another storage. For instance, if you've got an existing cache instance and you would like to export to an mbtile for a subset or an area.
Yes, you can. Yeah.
That's the geocache seed utility does that.
Transfer mode. You give it two caches and it will put, depending on. You guys did it.
I just manage them, but I don't know which.
I converted a bunch of tiles from sqlite to berkeley-db format.
Okay. Does it scale? I mean, if you have twice more users, can we put twice more tile cache servers?
It's very difficult to benchmark because it hits your bandwidth limits long before you hit the CPU limits. So
well, it scales to your bandwidth.
It scales to your bandwidth. It fills your bandwidth. So basically running as an nginx module, you can network bandwidth. Running as an nginx module, it can without problem serve up to 80,000 tiles a second, which is probably bandwidth in the order of multiple gigabytes per second. So, and even in that case, the CPUs aren't at 100%.
But have you done any benchmarks at all?
Yes, I have.
On seeding or serving?
On seeding in other cases and in network access also. I don't like to include, I used to include benchmarks in the presentations. I don't like to do it now because I don't find that benchmarks made by a single person are very valid. So if it's a team effort with the other tile server teams working on it, then that can be an interesting stuff. But having one person from one team benchmark different different implementations always makes the one person server be the fastest.
Other questions?
Often quite a lot of building up a cache takes a lot of time, a lot of processing power, and at the end of it you've got a very nice data set that I've come across use cases where it's nice to be able to access that by, you know, other applications. So I was wondering, is there any plan to produce something like a GDAL driver that you can pass in a map file and a MapCache XML file and sort of similar to a NCD TIFF container that lists the data sets that are in there and then you can kind of work on them and extract them?
So a VRT that lists multiple data sources, for example?
Say you've got a MapCache XML file that lists a number of different caches. I was just imagining a scenario where you point GDAL at that XML file. And then you can extract each of the data sets you're looking at.
Well, Google has some mini drivers for TMS. I don't know if it has WMTS also and WMS.
Yeah.
It does.
Yeah.
So you can point it to the capabilities document of your MapCache instance, and in that case, it'll see the cache as a data source through the network.
Yeah.
But
are you somehow tweaking the implementation of WMTS the way that it can be opened in ArcGIS?
I don't know the answer to that question. if you have some bugs, then do report them. But
so do you know if it's possible to open WMTS from MapCache in ArcGIS or S3 products?
I don't know. I don't know. You can definitely do it in QGIS. You can open WMS from MapCache in ArcGIS, but WMTS, I don't know.
Yeah, it's possible.
You can also serve out the ArcGIS generated cache with MapCache.
What version of WMS do you support?
1.1 and 1.1 and stuff to do the coordinate swapping for 1.3, but not the full 1.3. Well, it's not a fully WMS compliant server because you don't do all the get style stuff, the SLD passing, whatever. But basically, for getmap requests, you can go up to 1.3, and it knows what CRSs are inverted to understand that and return the correct tile for 4326.
Last question.
Supported platforms for running it? Is it kind of, I saw in the code that you can compile it with Visual C++, but...
Maybe some people have done it, I haven't.
Okay.
It's supposed to work, yeah.
Jeff McKenna has.
Yeah, with the new CMake stuff now, I don't know, but... It's supposed to, and if it doesn't, it's a bug. So. Yep.
Okay. Thank you.